Hello and welcome to Pick My Solar Live. It is more than just Facebook now. We have Periscope, I believe, Twitter, YouTube, saying hello to all of the platforms. I am your host today, Patrick Crowley, co-host, color commentator, resident expert. Andrew Baer, how are we doing, Andrew?
In all things.
Yes. Yes.
Not just solar. That's the key here.
Yeah. But yeah, today's deep dive is another relevant one. Last week we talked about the federal tax credit stepping down in 2019.
Yeah.
Another thing that was happening, or supposed to be happening in 2019, was one of the implications of NEM 2.0, which was a mandatory switch to time of use for California investor-owned utilities.
So this is basically going to be just a big change in how the bill is calculated.
Right.
Yeah. It's not going to necessarily benefit or hurt, depends on how you use your energy usage, but just the change is going to enable customers to save, potentially.
Right. And you touched on it exactly. It's just going to be change in how you're billed. And so for some people, it might be a complete non-factor. Other people could save money. Most likely, you're going to have a little bit of an increase in your bill, and we'll dive into the why of that. But the original statement, I guess, of NEM 2.0 was in 2020. All of the California investor-owned utilities, and if you're wondering what that means, Southern California Edison, SCE, Pacific Gas and Electric, PG&E, and San Diego Gas and Electric, SDGE, those are the three big utilities, investor-owned utilities in California. They are going to roll this out by 2020. Now, things have changed a little bit because this happened in 2017 in terms of what that actual rollout looks like, and we'll go into the time frame for each utility and kind of dive into what the implications might look like for you. And just to clarify, if you're an LADWP, this doesn't apply to you.
Right.
It's a municipal utility.
Yeah, yeah. And basically, there are two different ways that utilities are structured. They're either owned by like a municipality or they're owned by investors. And so these are just the big three owned by investors.
Correct.
So in 2019,
yes,
SDG&E is expected to be rolling out all of their customers onto TOU. In 2020, the same thing will happen for PG&E, and then in 2021 for Southern California Edison.
Yeah, and so really what that was the through the Public Utilities Commission, SCE and PG&E kind of asked for an extension, and they were granted that extension.
Yeah.
SDG&E is going to be rolling it out at some point in 2019. You can opt in advance. I believe at the end of March, they're going to have some shifts in terms of what you can and cannot be on. So if you want to get ahead of that now and kind of try and figure out what the right rate plan is for you, regardless of whether you're going solar, I guess that's an important clarification to make. This is not just solar related.
Yeah, good point. Yeah, everyone's going on to this. And one interesting point about the rollout is that PG&E and Southern California Edison, they were able to get the delay so that they could spend more time educating customers, or at least that was the argument they put to the California Public Utilities Commission, because they think, like as you mentioned, some customers will see a rate increase, potentially most customers will see their bill go up. So they want to be prepared to answer questions that customers are gonna have. They're probably not gonna be thrilled about that.
Sure.
Right. So that is their push for getting the delay so they can educate people, and hopefully people will have a better understanding of how to minimize the bill by the time that this comes through.
Right, and the biggest reason I think, like why can't they do it now? Why are they taking this time? It's because when NEM 2.0 went live, which for most of these utilities was for all of these utilities, it was when they hit 5% of solar adoption for their residential customers. That's when it went from 1.0 to 2.0. And when you went to 2.0, that's when the mandatory switch to time of use went to effect for customers who went solar.
Mm-hmm.
So now they're starting to learn some of the implications of that, since that's still a relatively new thing in the grand scheme of things, you know, just a couple of years, that they're looking at that mandatory time of use switch and seeing what it does to the billing.
Yeah.
And so there certainly can be the case to be made where it isn't any more time to figure it out, see what the implications, or what happened as a result of the mandatory switch.
Hopefully learn a couple of lessons, make it smoother.
Right.
For sure. So let's dive into the SDG&E rates that, or at least, so this is an example rate that is one of the various time of use rates that you could go on. So, but this is conceptually the idea for all time of use rates, which is there are different, I guess, categories. They call them peaks. So there's super off-peak, off-peak, and on-peak for this rate plan. Some of them might only have two. It's really all two or three from everything I've seen.
Yeah, and they might be named a little differently. You know, and just to kind of put a little bit more context behind this, it's when the demand on the grid is at the highest. And so it's the peak time for people to be using energy, and so these utilities are going to charge more for that time because their stress to produce that much energy for all the consumption that is needed. And if you look at the times, they kind of make sense if you think about it like that. So it's when is the peak pressure on the grid, which the non-peak pressure times, I guess, is one way to say it.
Yeah, so this is showing a peak from 4 p.m. to 9 p.m. That's the big peak. And that's three times as much, that energy costs three times as much to use as your super off-peak from 12 a.m. to 6 a.m. Mm-hmm. And so the idea is that consumers are going to be driven by this market to take some of their electricity usage from 4 p.m. to 9 p.m. and move it over to using from 12 a.m. to 6 a.m.
Right, and if we just, to circle back on the how does it affect me conversation, what is it going to do to my bill?
Yeah.
You know, if you're coming home from work 5, 6 o'clock, you get the TV on, you're cooking dinner, everybody's in the house, that's, everyone's doing it. For those kilowatt hours that you're using today, which are just being charged in tiers, they're going to be put into that bucket. You know, if you're working from home, or you know, let's say you work off shifts, you can see, you know, if you sleep during the day and you work during the night, you're going to see actually some savings on your bill because you're you know, so that kind of thing. So really just depends on when you're home and when you're using your energy.
Yeah.
And that's something that, you know, you should at least start to think about.
Yeah.
If not making any sort of change.
Absolutely. So like an example of a kind of change that a utility might educate their customer to do is if it's Tuesday or whatever and you're going to do laundry, instead of starting your laundry at 7 or 8, maybe start it at 9 if you can do that, you know, and finish up before you are trying to go to bed. Because then you're going to be using it in that off-peak time. You're going to pay less for that dryer usage. And, you know, you're going to be able to, so you'll save money, the utility's benefiting, and that is the theoretical whole reason for all of this.
Yeah, and the as we look into some of these other utilities, you can see, you know, the SDG&E one went all the way up to midnight for their peak, which is later than standard. And SDG&E has multiple rate plans, so you can kind of fit one to fit your needs.
Yeah.
But electric vehicles is a big consumer of energy, so you want to be charging that on your off-peak times. So as soon as you're out of those peak zones, go ahead and plug that thing in, and then you can get charge your electric vehicle at the lowest possible cost to you.
And just to give a quick plug on electric vehicles right there, most of these electric vehicle chargers are going to be smart, so you don't have to literally plug your vehicle in at midnight when it goes to off peak.
Yeah.
You program that into the charger.
Yeah, you don't have to stay up till midnight in San Diego to get those off peak charges. That's obviously a good thing to do unless you're a night owl. But we can dive right back into PG&E. This is one you're going to see that has a two-tiered rate plan, and PG&E also has multiple different ones. And this is just to give you a different context.
Yeah.
You can opt into this and actually pay more during your peak hours than standard and less in your off peak than standard.
Yeah. Yeah. So this is one just has two tiers. It's a little bit probably easier to understand than the last one. On peak, off peak. And same concept though as before.
Yeah. And so we can pop right back into SCE and just give you a picture of all three of those investor-owned utilities. And as you can see, it's going to vary, you know, for all of these. You can see that they're different, and even within the utilities, they're different.
Yeah.
So if you're looking at these and you think, whoa, that's really going to mess me up, take a step back. There's multiple plans. We can look at it for you, figure out what we can do to help you. Also, think about what Andrew said. How do I shift my loads? Maybe you do your laundry on the weekends instead of doing it during the week.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you could do things like that because oftentimes the stress on the grid is less on the weekends. They don't even have peak rates in some utilities on the weekends.
Yeah.
So you can start to shift your energy habits in preparation from this, even if you're not switching to time of use already.
For sure. That's true. And then looking at the Southern California Edison example, you can see here, so their peak is 2 p.m. to 8 p.m. And we the SDGE one we looked at was 4 to 9. So it's a little bit different. This one, you could argue, is more beneficial for solar because your peak is starting earlier when you'll be producing more of that solar energy. Their off-peak, their super off-peak in the green, also starts at 10 p.m. Mm-hmm. and it goes to 8 a.m. So that time frame's a little bit different. And then one of the other differences that's kind of interesting is now your on-peak versus your super off-peak is 4 times as much in this rate plan.
Right.
Versus the other one is about 3 times.
They're pushing you. They're pushing you to get, and they're giving you even the early morning and the late night as well. They're trying. They're really trying to shift your loads into those areas where the stress of the grid is at its lowest, so that they can accommodate that. And you know, obviously, the utilities want to be able to serve everyone. Blackouts are the worst possible thing, and of course, you know.
Right, and that's the reason for all of this. So to kind of circle back a little bit onto the utility side, they have a bunch of their generation plants. These will be mostly natural gas plants that are reserved for these on-peak times. Those plants are off and not producing any energy during these off-peak and super off-peak. Mm. So when they are producing energy, when they have to be turned on, you have to pay for that usage from a more expensive machine that has a limited on time. Mm. So you're really paying a whole lot extra for that usage, which is why these utilities want to charge you more.
Yeah, because someone's got to pay for it.
Someone's got to pay for it, right. And if they don't need to have that equipment installed, if so many people change their habits, then they're going to save money, and that's where you're going to save money.
Exactly. And you know, you touched on a very interesting thing, which was this being more beneficial for solar. We are a solar company, so we should probably touch on a little bit of how this might apply to solar, despite the fact that everyone's going to that. Mm-hmm. And so you touched a little bit on the grid reliability and all of the other things that the utility's looking to do. But my only point on that last slide was, if you're producing at, you know, if you're using energy all night, or before you're going on solar, you're using energy between 2 and 8, it's gonna be charged at the highest amount. What we're going to want to do is design you a solar system that's producing energy at that time,
right,
so you don't have to take energy from the grid when the cost is at its highest. And when the time comes down to around 8 o'clock, your solar is going to come closer and closer and closer to getting you energy all the way up towards the end of that peak time. Mm-hmm. And then that's where the battery might come into play if you want to get completely off those peak hours.
Yeah, for sure. Battery could come into play. And like, so with the solar design, like you're saying, you might want to face more of your panels on west-facing sides, mm-hmm. so you can produce evening energy. And yeah, that's certainly something we would factor in to save
right.
the most money.
Yeah, you're really looking to offset. Before, you would be offsetting energy, and now we're almost looking to offset cost.
Yeah, yeah. And so the implications of these new plans, these new TOU plans, the most obvious one, the whole reason for this to exist is really grid reliability. Mm-hmm. It's to be able to reduce the amount of time that everyone is taking a ton of energy from the grid. And then what utilities are going to have to do to make that happen is educate customers,
right.
as we were discussing, so they're not really ticked off by these potentially higher rates and having to change their habits and whatnot.
Or just the bill coming and it looks different, they don't understand it. You know,
yeah.
There's even if it doesn't change their rates, you know, if you were to get, you know, even if it was your phone bill, your car insurance, anything just came in and all of a sudden you're being billed differently, you didn't have an explanation or you didn't fully understand it, you'd at least have a red flag go up. So the utilities are going to be spending some time to make sure that people understand this, and hopefully the educational components, maybe, I don't know if they'll be adding things to the bill, which might say your bill on time of use. You know, I think that would probably be a step too far. I don't think that they're, I mean, it'd be nice, but I see that would probably be a little tough to pull off. But you know, they will have to spend a lot of time to get customers on board.
Yeah, absolutely. One additional thing that might get more popular are these smart devices, like smarter thermostats and smarter other pieces of equipment that can do what's called demand response to be able to help you load shift automatically. So you don't have to think about using your AC at a later hour. That unit will automatically be able to do it for you while keeping your home in a temperature range that you're comfortable with.
Yeah.
Yeah. So those smart devices might become more popular from the consumer side. And then there's also going to be the smart device that the utility needs to roll out to make this happen is smart meters.
Right. The one point I should make on smart devices as well and energy efficient devices, most utilities have either a marketplace mm-hmm. inside their utility platform, and some offer, they all pretty much offer rebates. Depends, the what products they offer rebates on varies by utility, but you might be able to get a certain amount of, you know, get a rebate back if you were to buy a smart thermostat or energy efficient smart, you know, washer and dryer or things of that nature. So
yeah.
Explore your utility's website, see what's on there, because if you're thinking about making an upgrade, you might be able to, one, get a very efficient and highly rated product and get a rebate back from your utility at the same time.
Yeah, yeah, that's a great point. And then, as you were mentioning before, solar plus storage may become a bit more common as it matters what time people are using
of
that
course.
Solar energy.
Yeah.
So batteries may become a little bit more useful. And as you were saying about the solar itself, which how you might want to arrange that might change. And the last one is low-income consumers. Because as you were saying, people's bills are likely going to go up, at least for a subset of people. So the utilities want to make sure that, and it's like a political thing as well, they want to make sure that low-income consumers can still handle their bill. Anyone who's struggling like month to month, any increase in their bill, they're going to really feel, you know. And
sure.
that's been one of the problems in the past with rollouts of smart meters and trying to change how people are billed.
Yeah.
So
most utilities do offer rate plans for that. And mm-hmm. so if you're at all, you know, struggling with your electric bill, or you want to look into see if you qualify, you know, it's worth a shot, because, you know, there's some significant discounts in some utilities. SCE, I know, has a pretty good discount.
Oh, great.
Yeah. I believe SDGE has one as well. PG&E, I would be surprised if they didn't offer something.
Mm-hmm. And so that wraps up the conversation on the IOU time of use rate plans.
Yeah. Do we have any questions on that? Back in the booth?
No questions from the booth.
Okay. All right. Fair enough. I guess we explained it pretty well.
Yeah. Well done. Good job, Pat. Which brings us to something we'll be doing all of 2019, which is reminding you that the 30% federal solar tax credit is going to step down at the end of this year. So you have 354 days left to get that 30%.
Yep. And
so get on it.
Yeah, and I would recommend try and get ahead of the end of the year rush. Also get your solar in before, you know, potentially the supply and demand of the market shifts prices up, as well as those summer bills. So
even
though you got the whole year, I think now is really an opportune time to kind of get ahead. You know, if you're someone who's paying your taxes in January instead of April, you're the type of person that I would be wanting to talk to about solar right now.
Do it.
Yeah. But yeah, again, we love questions, so feel free to ask any more.
And we are Pick My Solar. We'll
sure
help
are.
You go solar. And what we do is help get you a bunch of competitive quotes from installers that we've vetted. So if you're thinking about it, check out our website, pickmysolar.com.
Yeah.
All right.
So long.
It's been good.